not for broadcast. Not for broadcast.
Turn to that station.
Hi, welcome to Start Me Up, and usually we're ready to rock on the show. Today there's a bit of a dark feeling. You must have heard that Kurt Cobain took his life this past week and was just discovered yesterday. And don't really know what to say about it. It's terrible, it's depressing, it's sad, it's a real shame. And it's something that I think that we should talk about. So what we're gonna do in our show today on Start Me Up is we're gonna honor Kurt Cobain for being such a great songwriter. But we also wanna talk to you guys about this. We wanna understand how you feel about it, why you think you might have done it, if you know anybody in your life that's real depressed that maybe you might be able to help out. It's a very serious issue. So let's play some music from Nirvana. We'll honor Kurt Cobain. We're going to open up our phone lines. 1-800-265-MUCH is our phone. Please try and get through and have something of value to say. How you felt about or how you feel about Kurt Cobain, the music of the person and what he put himself through. Or you can fax us at 416-591-6824. Here's Nirvana and Start Me Up. You know, there's the old adage that money can't buy happiness. Well, Nirvana has been pretty successful in the past year, and I wonder if it's true that money can buy happiness.
Well, yeah, you can't buy happiness. I mean, that made me happy for a little while. But, I mean, I was just probably almost as happy with, you know, I look back on going to secondhand stores and stuff like that and finding a little treasure like that. And that actually meant more to me because it was more of a stab in the dark, in a way, you know, because you didn't know if you're going to be able to afford it, and you don't know what you're really looking for, and when you find it, it's more special to you, rather than, you know, having $1,000 and going into a store like that and just buying the whole store, you know. It's not as...
You're back with Start Me Up, and as you all know, we lost Kurt Cobain this past week, took his own life, shot his head off. And we're taking faxes and also phone calls to discuss this. It's going to have an impact on us no matter what. This guy has been one of the hottest recording stars in the past few years. He's led the whole grunge movement, and a lot of people respect him, and he took his own life. Facts here. The thing on everyone's mind today is, of course, the death of Kurt Cobain. I'm still trying to let it all sink in, but a part of Kurt will live forever. It's the part of him that was captured in the recording studio. I'm sure 10 years from now, Nirvana will be looked upon as one of the most influential bands of the 90s. Nirvana was a great band, and they touched people by the thousands. I'm sorry to see him go. My condolences to the Cobain family and all who knew him. Kurt Cobain, rest in peace. What's interesting, though, is that 10 years from now, you'll also think of what a shame it was that there wasn't another Nirvana album. Just imagine, they're just starting to get going. We have someone on the phone right now. Let's take a caller. Hello, is anyone there?
Hello.
Hi, who's this?
It's Jason.
Dave?
Jason.
Jason, sorry, the music's a little loud in here.
That's no problem.
Turn it down a bit.
No problem.
Jason, what do you have to say about Kurt Cobain?
Well, I'd just like to say I'm really saddened by the whole event. I know that Kurt was obviously a tortured soul, and I hope that he's found some sort of peace now that he's gone. But I'd just like to send my best wishes out to Courtney Love and Frances Bean. Because, I mean, it's going to be a very hard time for them to get through, and to anybody in the Cobain family. Did you say something?
No, I didn't.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't want to interrupt you. The other thing I really wanted to say was that I really hope, and I have this great fear, that Cobain's death is going to be a question on the Generation X version of the Trivial Pursuit game. and that it frightens me a great deal. I hope it means a lot more than just to be trivialized like that.
Mm-hmm. I think that also you mentioning his daughter and his wife brings up the idea that if someone, no matter how tortured they are, if someone like that has a responsibility, not to his fans, forget the fans. I mean, being a public figure is one thing, but he's married and he has a daughter.
Yeah.
And imagine what this woman, little girl, has to grow up with, and her wife, and the guilt and the pain.
Absolutely.
It's very selfish.
Yeah, I was going to say, I do think it's very selfish. We've read through many different articles on that he's had a lot of problems in his life with the drugs and whatever. And.
But Jason?
Yes.
Don't you have problems?
I think we all have problems, but I think we can deal with them and get through them.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe he just found there was no other way out, and it's kind of sad that it had
but
to be that way.
There's always a way out.
Always.
There is.
I totally
Jason,
agree.
Thank you so much for calling.
Thank you for having me.
Okay.
This is great.
Okay, bye. All right, let's see if there's any, we have another caller. Ready? Okay, let's put someone else on the line. Hello? Let's see. Oh, I'm too fast for you guys. I just want to say something that I did have an opportunity to meet Kurt Cobain when the album first came out, the second album, when In Utero just came out. We stood and talked for about an hour. He wasn't on drugs. He was very, very down to earth. He was a really sweet guy, and he seemed very happy. So when I see something like this happen, I don't know him, but it makes me wonder how this could have happened. All right, do we have anyone else on the line?
No?
All right, we lost a person. Are we we're going to play Lithium right now, and then we'll come back, and you can always phone us and fax us and tell us about your feelings about Nirvana and the loss of Kurt Cobain on Start Me Up. I tell you, a lot of those songs and those lyrics, if you can make them out, have some sort of a weird irony considering what Kurt Cobain has just done. We have someone on the phones right now who'd like to talk about what Kurt Cobain has meant to her. Sherry, are you there?
I'm here, hi.
Hi, Sherry. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Trent.
Okay, Sherry, so what do you have to say?
Well, I just said that basically I'd like to remember Kurt for what he's brought to the world and how he's revolutionized the industry. And I want to admire him and appreciate him for what he's done, not just remember him because he committed suicide.
Do you think that there's a danger of becoming a martyr? You know, that everybody starts to say, oh, but he was such a great guy just because he took his own life. How do we avoid that?
I don't know if you can entirely. Everyone has to, you know, sit down and think, you know, those who did appreciate you, think about what he meant to you and deal with it in your own certain way.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think you're going to be able to avoid that
right.
entirely.
Thanks very much for calling, Sherry.
Oh, it was good to talk to you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
If you have any ideas about what Nirvana meant to you or how we can avoid making this man into one of those modern-day martyrs, someone who takes his own life and then becomes a rock and roll hero because of that, please phone us or fax us. Our phone number is 1-800-265-MUCH, and our fax number is 416-591-6824. We'll be back with more Start Me Up right after this.
Either I've accepted it or I've gone beyond insane to where I can deal with it emotionally. I really don't care. I know that I'm too stubborn to allow myself to ever compromise our music or, you know, get so wrapped up in it and involved to where it's going to, you know, turn us into big rock stars. I mean, I just don't feel like that. Everyone else accuses us of it, but, you know, we're not as popular as everyone thinks, or we're not as rich as everyone thinks, you know? We've always had a good sense of humor. I don't think that's been translated very well, you know? But we'd rather laugh about it. Ha ha ha.
To reiterate the sequence of events, it happened yesterday. Apparently, an electrician went to Kurt Cobain's house. He went into a little area above the garage, a little cabin-like area, and found a man who had apparently put a gun to his own head and apparently committed suicide. Apparently, the police came down, they broke down the door of the house, they found a suicide note allegedly written by Kurt Cobain. Of course, we haven't heard 1,000,000% confirmation of it, though every newspaper across the country is saying that Kurt Cobain has committed suicide. We're asking for faxes and for phone calls about your thoughts on what happened. Received one, here's to a society where we love to push people to the top and do our damnedest to yank them down. Well done, folks. There goes another one. That's from Guy Glover from Victoria, B.C. Something to think about, the pressures of being in the public eye. We all think that being a rock star is so glamorous. But what about all those bad reviews and people not liking your music and the pressure? Sometimes, obviously, it can be very difficult. Let's take a phone call right now and let's see who we have. Okay. Hello?
Hello?
Hi, who's this?
This is Dave.
Hey, Dave, where are you calling from?
Calling from Sudbury.
Sudbury. Okay, Dave, tell me, what are your thoughts on Nirvana and Kurt Cobain?
Well, first of all, I really want to say that I'm sorry to see Kurt go, because I definitely have to agree that Nirvana is probably the most influential band in the 90s. And
can I ask you something for a sec?
Sure.
When you say the most influential, do you mean lyrically, in that the tone of their music?
Well, my thoughts on that are really the big push in the 90s so far has been with the alternative music. And that, well, pretty much originated in Seattle, like the first albums that started selling really well. And the first Seattle band to really make it from what I saw was Nirvana, which Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Well, obviously it was influential because you think it is. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It obviously hit a nerve in you.
But once sort of the media clued into Nirvana, then all of a sudden there was a big push, and now you have a lot of really excellent bands that might not have made it into the big time, like Alice in Chains and Soundgarden.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I wanted to say was that I am a big Mother Love Bone fan, and so I was really sorry to see Andrew Wood die. And so it just, it's a kind of a sad example of the pressure that we put these people under as like making them pop icons.
Now, do you think that it is actually we that put these people under pressures? Do you not think that they should have a family? I mean, this man is married, apparently happily. He has a mother that cares for him. He has a record company that's supposed to be taking care of him. His bandmates are apparently his best friends. Were there not people there to help him? I mean, of course he's in the public eye and there's a lot of pressure, but he also has the luxury of a big, comfortable house and a lot of people taking care of him. So there's the other side of being a rock star.
But, well, you have to, from the way I look at it is, I don't think anybody can really be prepared. Maybe Kurt just wasn't ready for or he wasn't one of the people who can live in the, like in the style of a big rock star.
Can I ask you something?
Sure.
Would it not have been easier to maybe quit the music business? The guy's made a million.
Well, maybe he was. I think first and foremost, he was a really good songwriter, and he. I think if you were to turn his back on doing what I would like to believe that he was put on this earth to do, then that would have been like sort of taking his own life in the same sense.
So you understand why he did it?
Well, I don't think anyone can really understand why you would take your own life, but I'm not going to... I think that he probably could have found another way to...
Yes.
Well, he could have found another way, but he made his choice, and... we have to respect him for it, I think, and
okay.
Remember him for, bringing us such great songs as Lithium and Smells Like Teen Spirit, and not condemn him for buckling under the tremendous pressure that he was put under.
Cool. Thank you very much for calling.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, bye. Let me read you something here. We actually have a fax sent to us in Gold Mountain, and that is his management company, Kurt Cobain's management company, and it's a release. And they say, we are deeply saddened by the loss of such a talented artist, a close friend, a loving husband, and a father. The intensity and creativity of Kurt's music and his thoughts will always be treasured. Kurt's art has transcended beyond the popular to speak to millions around the world. Painfully, Kurt's passions and feelings about his fame overwhelmed him. We will miss him, his music, and his friendship deeply. That's from Gold Mountain Entertainment. So do we have another phone call? All right, let's take one more call. Hello?
Hi.
Hi, who's this?
This is Mike.
Hey, Mike, where are you calling from?
East York.
Okay, Mike, what are your thoughts about what we're talking about?
Well, you heard him say it himself, you know, he never wanted to be a big rock star and, you know, the life of making millions. But the thing I'm talking about is his daughter. Like, you know, he has a daughter and a family, and I think it was very selfish. Like, everything we're talking about, Kurt and Nirvana, but I think we should think about more than anything his family, you know what I mean? His daughter, his wife, his friends, you know what I mean? And like you said you met him before and he wasn't high and, you know, he was sober and you were talking to him and he's a really nice guy. But the part that I think a lot of us haven't seen is him on the drugs or taking the drugs. Do you understand? Like, the setbacks from that. And I think there's a lot of pressure put on in the rock business. Like you said, it's not all that good being a rock star, you know what I mean? Because there is people that aren't going to like you. Like, not everybody's going to like you. There is people that aren't going to like you, and you are going to have some negative feedback. And I guess, you know, he's the best I could say came out of this is that if he was under a lot of pressure, he's in a better place. And, you know, but I really feel for his daughter and his wife.
You know, Mike, it's funny for me. A better place would have been somewhere in the country. He quits the business, and he lets Courtney, because she's in a band called Hole, lets her be the rock star of the family, and he takes care of the daughter. You ever hear of a house husband? Girls love it.
Yeah, sure.
Why not do that? You know, that would have been very cool.
Well, that's a part of him I don't think we'd probably see, but
that's right.
You know, there was a lot of pressure put on him, probably, and I mean, I know what it's like to be to the point where to almost kill yourself.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's not worth it. There's always a way you can work it out.
That's right.
And unfortunately, maybe he didn't have someone close enough to him to talk to him. Like, I mean, I'm sure he could have had lots of counseling or something like that. But, you know, it's just sad he has to do this and leave his daughter and his wife. And
Mike, thank you very, very much for calling in. I like what you're saying. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, we're going to get to some more music right now. This is another one from Nirvana on Much. This is a very special edition of Start Me Up. I'm Erica Ehm, and as you probably know, Kurt Cobain from Nirvana took his own life this past week. People just have found out about it yesterday, and we want to talk about what it means, why he would do that, and how it affects us, his fans. Something that you may not know is that the last album, In Utero, was actually supposed to be called I Hate Myself and I Want to Die. They decided not to use that and instead to take that song and put it on this soundtrack for the Beavis and Butthead experience. And when you hear about things like that, it makes your skin kind of crawl. And perhaps people should have been taking a little more note of someone who is really troubled, really tortured in his heart. And it's also a little bit of a wake-up call for us, because perhaps we know other people, our friends, that are having a hard time, and we have to pay attention to them and start talking and don't leave them alone. Okay, let's take a phone call now from someone who has some strong feelings about what Kurt Cobain has done. Hello?
Hello.
Hi, who's this?
It's Chris.
Can't even hear you. Hold on one sec. Technical difficulties. Sorry, there we go. What's your name?
Chris? Yeah.
All right, Chris, where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Charlottetown, Prince Edward Island.
Okay, what's your feelings about the past few days?
I don't know. When I heard about it, I kind of had mixed feelings.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I felt sorry that a human life was taken, but I didn't really have any sympathy for him because the way that it happened, like the whole suicide thing, and I'm not really for that. I mean, you hear about people who, they kill themselves, like, every day, and it really doesn't affect us. But when a rock star, somebody who's in the public eye, any kind of entertainer...
Why do you think it affects us more?
Because there are people who are looking up to these people. I mean, you know, Kurt Cobain was hero to many, 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 many people. To all his big fans, I'm sure they're thinking, you know, what happens if there's somebody out there who is thinking the same thing? And because Kurt Cobain did it, my big hero, why, who's to stop that guy from doing it?
So how do we stop it? What do you suggest?
I don't know if there is a way to stop it. Mm-hmm. There's a, you can just, I don't know.
It'd I mean, is like this, have you talked to your friends about this?
Would I?
Have you talked? Is this something that you and your friends, you're hanging out and someone said, oh my God, did you hear about Kurt Cobain?
No, not really, but I have been in the situation where somebody has actually come to me and said that they were going to do it, and, you know, I got mad at them because I don't really think suicide's the answer. It never is. It, like, it just never.
But you listen. You listen to your friend's problem, though, even though you're mad at them.
I don't. Mm-hmm. I don't tell them that they're wrong, but I tell them that there are other ways to do it.
Exactly.
And it's no matter who you are, it's not the right answer. Suicide is not the way to go about it. Like, I don't care if you have all the problems in the world. Suicide is never the answer.
Well, Chris, thank you very much for calling in.
Thank
I appreciate what you had to say.
Okay.
Okay. Bye. Let me read you a poem that we received. This is from Amber Burbeck from Niagara Falls. She's 14 years old, and she wrote, "A great singer died yesterday in a pool of his blood he lay. His age was only 27, but now he's somewhere up in heaven. A wife and a child he left behind. Of their sorrow, he was obviously blind. Suicide is not uncommon, but why, I ask myself, did it have to be his life that was put upon a shelf?" From Amber Burbeck. And another fax came in from Yvonne Byes and Jen Stanley from Cayuga, Ontario. And they write, "We would like to extend our condolences to Kurt's family and friends. His music was very inspiring and touched our hearts. Even though he is gone, his music and memory will stay with us. It's been only a day and we miss him. Because of him, suicide should not be idolized. It's not the only way out." Let's take another call. Hello? Oh, so close, but... Hello?
Hi.
Hi, who's this?
I'm Tanya from Windsor, Ontario.
Hi, Tanya. So what do you have to say about the past few days?
I'm not a real Nirvana fan, and I don't really know much about Kurt Cobain, but from what I've seen now, I think he's a selfish coward. And he was willing to leave his wife and child behind because I think he believed his suicide would skyrocket him to fame, and that's exactly what's happening. I think he's gloating right now and laughing.
So how do you think we should be handling this?
I understand a person died, and he was a famous person, and I know that, there should be some kind of tribute, maybe a couple videos and a little, I don't know. But this is just ridiculous. I'm sorry. The radio station down here is playing his Nirvana over and over, and everywhere, that's all I see, and I think it's sending out the wrong message, and it's making him look like a hero. Like, even though everybody's downplaying suicide, it's making him look like a hero.
I know, it's definitely, that's why we want to talk about this and hear what you have to say, because I agree with you. He can't become a martyr. That's very important. His mom says that her son just joined the stupid club.
Well, that's exactly what he did.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much for calling.
Thank you.
Okay. The whole kerfuffle is that Kurt Cobain has written some great songs. He's touched our hearts. He's rocked out like crazy. He's inspired a whole grunge scene in Seattle and then bands from all around the world. And we have Kurt Cobain talking about music, which is what he did on Start Me Up.
You guys don't like explaining anything to do with your music or to do with what you're doing.
Just like freaking Ricardo said, "Splain, Lucy, splain." Lucy never did.
Ricky!
Now, okay, now why don't you like talking about it, though? What's the problem with going on camera and just relating a little story to do with it?
There's nothing to be said. It's all in the music, man. It's all in the music. It's all in the meat.
You don't think that people that are fans of you would like to hear what you had in mind, maybe, or what you were...
I'd like to hear what they have in mind,
Yeah.
Or how they interpret it.
You would.
Cool. Yeah. I'd like to get some letters. This is what my analytical
my
idea
personal
is, what critique. Your lyrics are about, It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter, man.
May 2nd on Much Music.
I'll apologize. Come as you are. Where the bad folks go when they die? They don't go to heaven where the angels fly. My girl, don't lie.
Nirvana Unplugged, May 2nd on the Much Music Big Ticket.
Really, that wasn't planned, but there is going to be a special look at Nirvana, April 2nd. It's our unplugged look, and I'm sure there'll be a lot more discussion about Nirvana on April 2nd when we talk about what Nirvana has gone through, and I guess it would be the end of the band, end of an era as well. Let's take another phone call right now. Who do we have on the line? Anybody? Hello?
Hello.
Hi, who's this?
This is Dave.
Hey, Dave, where are you calling from?
North Bay.
North Bay. Okay, Dave, what are your thoughts on what's going on right now?
Well, I think, I can reason with how Kurt felt. You know, it's sometimes you just can't handle it anymore.
But you do, obviously, if here you are still talking about it.
Yeah, you know, you just live it the way you live it. You know, you can't always, I don't know, he wanted to do this for a long time. He wasn't a happy person, obviously. You know, it's hard to live and, you know, live up to everybody else's expectations. You know, you gotta get the grades in school. You've gotta work really hard, and if you don't, you get fired. You know, it just gets to be too much sometimes.
Life is tough, there's no doubt about it. But everybody has to deal with the same problems. I mean, everybody has different problems, but everybody has problems.
Yeah, but the thing is that some people just can't handle the stress.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think, you know, with his lifestyle and everything else, I think it just got to be a little too much.
Now, explain to me, if someone came to you, a friend of yours, who's going through similar things, who's having a hard time
I've
at
had,
work.
I've had friends commit suicide, and it's a hard thing to deal with. There's nothing you can say to them.
How come you didn't stop them?
I tried, but you can only say so much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, there's only so much you can do to help them. Obviously, if they don't want to live, and there's nothing that you can do.
Now, what kind of effect do you think this could have on young people who are watching the show right now, who are big fans of Kurt Cobain?
I think, if anything, I think it's going to do the reverse. It's not going to, I don't think it's going to drive anybody to kill themselves. I think it's actually going to make people think about doing it.
What do you think they'll think?
Well, I think it's probably going to be, you know, like, they're going to look at it and say, well, you know, he was obviously a little worse off than I was. You know, maybe he didn't get enough help, or maybe he didn't have the friends that he needed, or whatever.
Isn't that the irony of thinking, here he is. In fact, I have a fax about it. I can't believe that Kurt could do that to himself. I mean, he's good-looking, talented, and very popular. I would never do that to myself. That's from Bill Papadatos from Malton, Ontario. I mean, you think about it. The guy is rich, he's married, he has a family, he's in the biggest rock band in the world, he gets to travel the world, meet the coolest people. And you're calling him, well, he's had a tough life.
You know? Yeah, but it's the same as Hendrix and Morrison and people like that. You know, sometimes it just gets to your head or it gets to be too much, and you go a little far, you know. I'm not saying what he did was right, but I'm just... He's obviously, like somebody said earlier, he is in a better place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, this is not a good place for anyone.
Dave, you're bringing me down.
Sorry.
Okay.
The way I feel.
It's okay. Thanks for calling.
Okay,
bye-bye. Yeah, it's very interesting, this fax that we received from Bill. I completely agree with that. You think about what this man has and the potential that he has. In fact, he never had to continue staying in the band if it was really tough for him. There's always another alternative. If he was having such a rough time, his band members should have helped him out and said, get out of the band, let's take a break. And as a matter of fact, they were in the midst of taking a break because he was recuperating from that close to fatal overdose. Another fax that we received. Nirvana's music made Kurt Cobain larger than life. I think he just wanted to be a real person. And I don't know where this is from, but I agree. It's tough. It's sometimes living in front of a camera can be a bit of a fake existence. Perhaps that just was not his bag. We have another caller on the line. Hello.
Hey. How you doing?
Good. Who's this?
This is Steve. I'm phoning from Port Alberni. It's in B.C.
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Okay, Steve, tell me what's on your mind.
Well, I tell you, I'm living here in B.C. We get all of our major American affiliate stations from Washington State, plus a couple independent. All they're talking about is Kurt Cobain, which is understandable. Hometown guy, hometown hero, made it big. But it is a bit of an overkill. He had him on fax. He had a few rapid faxes. What I thought was cool was he ended the Coca-Cola Countdown with one of his songs, which I thought was kind of classy.
Mm.
But taking up all of... Start Me Up with the Nirvana thing might be a bit much.
Mm-hmm. Do you think it's important for us to discuss it, though, because he was so influential and there's a lot of young people, and maybe not so young people, that could be affected by this emotionally?
Yes, you have a point there. I started watching this about an hour ago and I thought, oh no, here we go again.
Yeah.
But I started watching and discussing it is a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, if there's one person out there who changes his mind right now who's watching this thinking about killing himself, if they change their mind and talk to somebody, phone a friend or something, that's a good thing.
Do you have any fond memories about Nirvana? Any song that really related to or anything about the music that had struck you?
I tell you what, I never really was a big fan.
I know. Well, the record's going to start selling like crazy anyway, so get in the stores while you can.
All righty.
All right. Thanks very much for calling.
Bye-bye.
All right. I mentioned earlier at the top of the show that I had the opportunity to interview Nirvana, the whole band, and I interviewed each of the guys separately for about 30 minutes each. And as I mentioned, Kurt Cobain was charming. He was very nice. He wasn't on drugs. He seemed quite happy and actually quite surprised that he was so happy. I could tell that he probably had his darker moments. And one of the things that I wanted to talk to him about was his family life. He was really into that big time. And one of the things that struck me was because his lyrics and the whole band's attitude was so dark, so much of that Generation X thing, I wondered why he would even consider bring another young person into the world. So take a look at this. You see the world for what it is. Did you ever have second thoughts about bringing a child into the world the way
it
is?
Oh yeah, absolutely, yeah. I really can't describe what changed our attitude so fast. I think, you know, I really was a lot more negative and angry and everything else a few years ago, but that had a lot to do with not having a mate, you know, not having a steady girlfriend and stuff like that. So I, you know, that was one of the main things that was bothering me that I wouldn't admit at the time, you know. So now that I've found that, the world seems a lot better for some reason, you know. It's just, it really does change your attitude about things. You know, I mean, 4 years ago I would have said, you know, the classic thing, like, you know, how dare someone bring a child into this life, you know, it's just completely a terrible way to go and, you know, the world's going to explode any day and stuff like that, but once you fall in love, it's a bit different.
If you just tuned in, this is a very special edition of Start Me Up. We're here talking about Kurt Cobain. As you may or may not know, he took his life this past week, and his fans all over the world are grieving for him. Some are angry, some are sad, some understand what he's been through. A lot of people just can't understand why a guy who seemed to have everything would take his own life. We're taking phone calls, faxes, playing his music, and trying to discuss this. So we have someone on the phone right now. Let's see who it is.
Hello?
Hello.
Hey.
Hey, who's this?
It's Chris.
Sorry?
Chris.
Chris, where are you calling from?
Victoria, BC.
Okay, Chris, what are your thoughts on what just happened this past week?
I heard one girl come on the phone and she said that she doesn't see why you guys are talking about it, like on the whole show.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's good because, like, I'm only 17 years old and, you know, I looked up to that guy, you know, quite a bit, and like a lot of my friends do. I can just see kids going and do it just because they think that he did it, you know?
Now, does it make you want to do it?
Oh, no. I'm just saying, you know, I know a lot of kids that are, you know, low on themselves, you know? I mean, they look up to that guy and they say, if he did it, I can do it.
So do you
like Jim Morrison and
but
other guys.
People didn't kill themselves when Jim Morrison eventually died, if he's really dead.
Yeah.
But you know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think also that it's kind of ironic that a couple weeks ago he went into a coma, too.
Well, it might have been a warning sign.
Yeah.
It's the kind of thing that you probably have to deal with your friends. You said you're 17, some of your friends are going through rough times.
Yeah.
And you have to look for warning signs of people that are having a rough time.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You talk to your friends if you're low?
Yeah, like, actually, April 22nd, my friend killed himself last year. And it was the day before my birthday.
Wow.
And that was kind of hard to deal with. It took a long time, and after that, I was going through rough times. And, you know...
Now, when something like that happens, did it come as a complete surprise to you and your friends?
Yeah, I was, you know, at school, and then I went out for one class, and then I came out, and everybody was crying, and, you know, it was like a shock.
Okay, Chris, what do we learn from this?
Just keep on going. No matter how hard you're struggling, keep on going.
Cool. Thanks a lot for calling.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Let's take a look at a couple of faxes that have come in. This one reads, a lot of people have said that Kurt killed himself because he couldn't handle the fame he acquired through his success with Nirvana. Many people will probably blame him and say that he is selfish and irresponsible for taking his own life. But what we don't seem to realize is that we are the ones who pushed him into that position. We bought the albums, we went to the concerts, and we requested the videos. We all contributed to the pressure. We should all step back and look at how we treat famous people like Kurt. People we place on pedestals and submit to godlike status. They are mortal too. There are thousands of ways that he could have dealt with his problem, and he opted for the wrong way out. But when you're in that kind of a position, you can't see any of those thousands of options. It's impossible to relate to someone who obviously felt so trapped and alone. Kurt is gone. It's useless to blame him when the onus is on us too. We'll miss him. Janelle and Cher from Toronto. We also have a fax into us from some guys in Unionville. They're huge Nirvana fans, Jacqueline, Chris Blout, J.P. Congas, and John Haston. Yesterday, inspirator and musical genius Kurt Cobain took his own life. We as fans were shocked and saddened by his terrible event. A great idol in the eyes of us and many other people is dead. We always thought that Nirvana were highly underrated and didn't receive the recognition they deserved, although they may not have wanted that publicity anyway. From all of us in Unionville, Ontario, we truly hope he has reached a state of total happiness. Nirvana. For me, all I can think of is his wife and child who are apparently on the road in Europe. Courtney Love from the band Hole was promoting her album. Just stop and think for a second about how she must have felt when she heard the news. Must be so terrible. And to want to put anyone through that is beyond me. I really can't understand it. Let's see if we have another phone call ready. Is there someone else on the line now? All right. Hello, who's there?
Hello?
Hi, who's this?
Hi, it's Jason.
Hey, Jason, where are you calling from?
I'm calling from St. Catharines, Ontario.
All right, Jason, what do you have to say?
Not that it's sad, but it's sort of tragic in a sense that he killed himself. But just the fact that he's sort of suddenly being idolized again. And I realize there are a lot of, younger kids out there, like the one caller said, who looked up to him and stuff like that. But I don't know why we're putting him in giving him such high regards.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I've never been a great fan of Nirvana. I like the music. He made good music. And the other guy said, we pushed him into that. Well, it was a life he chose, like to be a musician and things like that. And I'm sure he might not have wanted the huge amount of success that he got. But you can't help but think about the other people who commit suicide, who are just, say, the 40 hours a week kind of people, who, some people have problems just trying to make ends meet,
mm-hmm.
and that's why they do it. This guy was pretty set for life. He had money. If he really wanted to and take care of his problems, just give an example, go to Sweden, Like, just, he could have became a recluse, not that his fans would ever always leave him alone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost like, if you notice through other people, just say like Elvis and stuff like that, when they go, if you want to say before their time, whether he went before his time or not, I think we have to be careful not to make him more than he was, because I don't think enough people really knew that much about him.
I agree with you. I agree.
I'm not going to sit there and talk and say, yeah, I understand he had all these problems. I don't know him. I didn't know anything. I knew that he made good music, and he changed the music scene quite drastically, and for that, the music scene is better off for it. But I think we just have to keep it more in perspective, that's all.
That's right, and I think what's important is the more we discuss it, the more we talk about it, we realize we don't know the guy. He's just a guy who lived in Seattle, who made music, who wrote good songs, and scored the big one. He won the lottery in the music business, but we don't know him personally, and he's not the greater for having killed himself.
Exactly. It's almost, you have to look at it again, it's his family again. Like, he left his kid and his wife, and you just see in that interview there, he said the greatest thing that happened to him is when he met his wife, and now he wanted to bring a kid in there. So obviously he had many problems, and it's always good to talk about him, but it's usually, if you're really quiet about it, that's almost a danger sign,
yeah.
If you know what I mean.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I agree with you, and thank you very, very much for calling.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
All right. It's so emotional talking about this kind of stuff. It's very heavy. Obviously, Nirvana has touched a lot of people's lives, not necessarily through their lyrics, because sometimes they were hard to understand, but through the music. And Kurt Cobain has been a huge influence on the music scene in the 90s. And we have now some music and the words of Kurt Cobain on Start Me Up.
Hey, hey, hey.
closing of the chapter of the formula we've been using, you know? It's like grunge is, it's really kind of boring for us, you know? It's something we can't deny, and we're not gonna stop playing the old songs live, whoops. And, but, you know, our tastes are just changing so rapidly that we're really experimenting with a lot of stuff, and it might get too indulgent and be really embarrassing for the next album, but we can't put out another album, and this is just like the last chapter of three chord grunge music for us.
I can sit here and say that I'll do this for a few more years and then have a normal life, but I know that in 10 years, sure, I'll miss it, you know. There's a lot of things about this that I'll miss. There's a lot of things about it that I'll be glad I don't have to deal with anymore.
What are you
going to
miss?
I'll miss being on stage with Chris and Kurt, you know, and some of the insane shit that happens when we play, stuff like that, you know. The good little moments here and there.
Chris and Dave and I haven't changed at all. I mean, believe it or not, we get along just as well as we ever did. You know, we're just as the same passive-aggressive people as we used to be. You know, we never fight. And when we're pissed off at each other, we just hold it under our breath and have respect for one another in that way. You know, it's just, it's easier to work that way, you know, because we have a mission, I guess.
Well, we're just about out of time here on the special edition of Start Me Up. We have one more phone call, and I believe Allison is on the line.
Hi.
Hi, Allison. Where are you calling from?
North Bay.
Allison, what do you have to say?
Well, I don't really feel any sympathy for him at all. I think what he did was wrong. And you read something about there were two girls, Cher and some other girl from Toronto, and mm-hmm. they were blaming us.
Mm-hmm.
And I really don't think it's our fault, because he got himself into this mess. Like, if he didn't like the way his life was, he could have changed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I just disagree big time with what he did. And I don't feel any sympathy for him at all. And I'm angry that everybody's feeling so bad for him.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, he had a choice, and he killed himself. And I don't think he went to heaven. That's one thing. I don't
Monica,
think he's in a better place.
Come here. This is Monica. I just want you to meet someone here. This is Monica. She works here at Much. And you were saying something similar. Why don't you just say what you...
Yeah, I was thinking that I don't think it was really success that sort of did it for him, because from the interview clips I saw, it seemed like he was handling it okay. And
mm-hmm.
I mean, we can speculate whether it was that really, you know, sort of pushed him to do it. But I think, I mean, you have to have control of your own destiny, and you can't let success rule you. I mean, there are so many other options, and you were talking about that earlier. And you know,
yeah.
you have choices. You control your own destiny.
Yeah.
Exactly. Well, Allison, Monica, thank you very, very much. We're going to wrap up our retrospective look at the career of Kurt Cobain. Just remember, please, that May 2nd, when we have our Unplugged show, we're also going to do a bit of a tribute to the band, a final tribute to an end of an era, I guess, of the end of grunge. Our last fax was sent to us from David Gessen's record company. It's a statement from the record president, Ed Rosenblatt, and he says, "We are all devastated by the unbelievable tragedy of Kurt Cobain's death. The world has lost a great artist, and we've lost a great friend. It leaves a huge void in our hearts. Obviously, Kurt will be missed by us all." Here's Heart-Shaped Box and Start Me Up.